Hello, I'm happy to speak with you today about imaging and Parkinson's disease. Now, this is an enormous topic with more than 14,000 papers related to the information I'm going to try and cover in the next 12 minutes. And importantly, nearly half of those papers have appeared in the past 5 years. So the main three roles for imaging in Parkinson's are one, to make a diagnosis, two, as an objective measure. This is particularly important as we develop disease-modifying therapies and to see whether the therapies actually do what they're supposed to do. And finally, to apply a more personalized approach where we could use imaging potentially to stratify for entry into clinical trials, to identify people who have prodromal disease, in other words, before they actually develop Parkinson's, and perhaps even to predict disease trajectory. So the two main diagnostic issues are, first of all, is there a loss of dopamine neurons, such as Parkinson's versus essential tremor? Or perhaps more importantly, is it Parkinson's or is it a related condition, one of the so-called Parkinson plus or atypical forms of Parkinson's? So this just shows MRI. Just standard MRI in progressive supranuclear palsy with thinning of the midbrain shown from the side and from above. Now, you can actually do formal measurements quite easily to get an index that tells you about the likelihood of having progressive supranuclear palsy. But importantly, MRI can do other things besides just looking at the simple structure. So here's a study where the authors looked at multiple system atrophy using multiple MRI modalities, all with MRI, looking at gray matter loss in the cerebellum, at expression of iron or the deposition of iron in the brain, at the diffusion of water molecules, and how much the water molecules line up. And by combining those four markers together, they get a much better measure of disease and can differentiate between multiple system atrophy and, say, Parkinson's. Nuclear imaging, where we use a radio tracer, again, can tell the difference between loss of dopamine versus preserved dopamine, but it really isn't helpful for differentiating between Parkinson's and atypical Parkinson's. However, if you use PET to assess glucose utilization in the brain, there is a characteristic pattern with increased glucose use in the basal ganglia and reduced use elsewhere. That is characteristic of Parkinson's disease, and it is different from the patterns that are seen in atypical forms of Parkinson's, such as multiple system atrophy, where there's loss of glucose use in the basal ganglia as well as the cerebellum, and progressive supranuclear palsy, as well as others. So this may actually be more helpful for diagnosis, certainly than dopaminergic imaging. One of the main concerns with dopaminergic imaging is whether or not it will allow us to really monitor the loss of dopamine nerve cells over time. Historically, we've thought that there's probably a good correlation between the imaging markers and the number of surviving dopamine nerve cells. But this study suggests that there is not such a good correlation. And this study was from the PPMI, the Parkinson's Progression Marker Initiative. And it appears as if there is a relationship between motor severity and dopaminergic markers. But that's really only when you lump together the healthy people and the people with Parkinson's. And if you just look at the people with Parkinson's alone, there's no such relationship. And more importantly, there's not a good relationship between change over time in the imaging and change over time in clinical severity. Perhaps more concerning is there are lots of examples where you can give a treatment that improves the scans, such as transplant or GDNF, but does not necessarily result in clinical improvement. Now, another MRI marker that has been used is neuromelanin, which is deposited in the dopamine cells in the midbrain and also in the noradrenergic cells in the locus coeruleus here. And if you compare healthy versus Parkinson's with REM sleep behavior disorder, you can see a marked reduction. But you also see that reduction in people who have REM behavior disorder but have not yet developed Parkinson's, suggesting this may be a good marker. And it seems to correlate with dopaminergic imaging markers in the brain. Another MRI marker that is quite recent and showing promise is the imaging of free water, work done by David Valancourt in Florida. And you can see that this increases over time. Furthermore, the patterns are different between different forms of Parkinsonism. And so they have used machine learning. This is an international collaboration to compare people with Parkinson's against those with atypical Parkinson's. And you can see that this automated image analysis is very sensitive and specific to differentiate between those, but also between two forms of atypical Parkinson's, multiple system atrophy and progressive supranuclear palsy. Now, we would really like to be able to study the underlying pathology in Parkinson's. And one form of pathology is abnormal inflammation in the brain. In this case, investigators in Denmark have used a PET marker for inflammatory cells, so-called microglia, to look at activity in the substantia nigra. And these are, again, people who have REM behavior disorder but have not yet developed Parkinson's. And despite that, you can see that there is evidence of increased inflammation in the substantia nigra. Now, the challenge is that most of the markers available to date to study inflammation are actually quite difficult to interpret, and there are numerous technical challenges that I'm not going to get into. But of course, the major underlying pathology in Parkinson's is the deposition of abnormally folded protein, in the case of Parkinson's, alpha-synuclein. In other conditions, it's other proteins that are deposited in an abnormal conformation. And so this is a recent study done with one particular marker for tau protein, which is deposited in Alzheimer's disease and in progressive supranuclear palsy. But you'll see in contrast, very little, if any, deposition in the brains of people with Parkinson's or other so-called synucleinopathies. Now, we did studies using a different tracer for tau protein, and we did this in collaboration with investigators in Japan. And we found that, as expected, there was increased uptake in people with progressive supranuclear palsy. But uptake was also increased in people who had abnormal deposition of alpha-synuclein. So that made us think that this might actually be a useful marker to study alpha-synuclein in the brain. So we've since gone on to do that. This work is unpublished and has been spearheaded by Michele Matarazzo, who has now returned to Spain but was working with us in Vancouver. And you can see that there is increased uptake of this marker in the striatum, more than in the substantia nigra of people with Parkinson's disease, which may suggest that the disease is actually starting in the nerve terminals rather than in the cell bodies. And additionally, there's evidence of more widespread increases in uptake through other areas of the brain, as seen here. Now, our collaborators in Japan have recently developed another marker that they feel is more specific for alpha-synuclein, as you can see here in an animal model of abnormal synuclein deposition. But this is still very early work and evolving. Now, finally, can we use imaging to predict what will happen over the course of the disease? So Alain Daguerre in Montreal has looked at patterns of atrophy or loss of tissue in the brain. We typically don't think of this as being particularly striking in Parkinson's disease, but he's shown that this pattern relates to the degree of connection to the substantia nigra, and that the degree of abnormality is related to the change in global disease severity over time. So it may indeed be predictive. Another group in the UK has looked specifically at this structure, the basal forebrain, which sends cholinergic projections. And they have found that the measure here will predict future cognitive decline in people with Parkinson's disease. And this group in Italy has looked at patterns of activation and connectivity in the brain using MRI. So this is in people who have early Parkinson's and are not yet on treatment, and yet they can predict the future development of impulse control disorders in these people. Finally, I'd just like to re-emphasize the importance of doing multimodal imaging. It's not one type of imaging versus another. This is very, very recent work done on a hybrid scanner that combines both PET and MRI. And by doing this, we can simultaneously look at patterns of activation in the brain, as well as the degree and distribution of dopamine release in the brain while people are performing different types of tasks in the scanner, and see whether that's different in Parkinson's and how we can impact that. Thank you very much for your attention.